All right, gentlemen, let's go ahead and do a little 7-on-7. We're gonna call this drill The Exorcist, because it's all about controlling possession.
All right, let's go!
So we'll get some flowers, because this spot here is where Sam died. It's very sad.
Oi, walk away.
All right, Grandad, keep your wig on.
Thanks, Roy.
Yeah, you're good.
Hey, Sam, come here a sec.
Coach, I'm sorry.
You know what the happiest animal on Earth is? It's a goldfish. You know why?
No.
Got a 10-second memory. Be a goldfish, Sam. Yeah? Yeah, you got it. Go ahead.
Rumination is like emotionally picking at scabs. It's a preoccupation with the wound that does absolutely nothing to help our healing, and it actually prolongs it. Rumination is different than helpful self-reflection. While reflection can provide learning and insight or healthy emotional processing that moves us forward, rumination, on the other hand, provides no new insight. There is really no learning that takes place. It's simply rehashing the past. It's not processing our feelings or working through our hurts. It's not thinking about or applying helpful feedback. Ultimately, it's not an effective use of mental and emotional energy. It takes up a lot of mind space, but doesn't give us anything back. Instead, it makes things worse because it employs mental and emotional resources that could be used to move forward and often keeps us bringing up and recycling negative emotions.
Oh, come on, fellas. How long has it been since y'all won up at Everton?
60 years ago.
Wow, that is a heck of a long time. Okay.
So we got that going on, and obviously we're bummed out that O'Brien tore his butt.
It's my upper hamstring, Coach.
Well, you tore your butt, son. There's nothing to be ashamed of, okay? It happens. People tear their butts all the time in athletics. You're not alone, man. Hey, Coach, you've torn your butt a few times, right?
Three times.
Butt's an amazing muscle. God is my witness. Your butt will heal.
Now, personally, I'm far from perfect at avoiding ruminating. And letting things go can be easier said than done. But here are four quick suggestions that help me and some people some of the time. Keep in mind, this is just a quick flyby, and each of these principles deserves its own episode. But rather than take too much time here, I'm going to just note them briefly and then put some links down in the notes section of this video if you'd like to explore an individual principle more. So here we go. Suggestion number one. If you feel you get stuck ruminating a lot, my first suggestion is to meet with a mental health professional and rule out other mental health diagnoses that tend to get our brains stuck on certain thoughts. Things like OCD, being on the autism spectrum, unprocessed trauma, these can all get our brain locked up. So we need to rule these out, because if these are present, we're going to treat these differently than run-of-the-mill rumination. Second, we can work on our ability to notice we are ruminating so we can interrupt the cycle. Some would call this skill mindfulness. And whether this is meditating 5 minutes a day or using visualization or cognitive reframing, the goal here is to enable our inner impartial spectator. So we're better able to notice our thoughts, feelings, and reactions as they come up and do so non-judgmentally. Third, we can try the principle of strategic self-distraction. Experience shows that trying to suppress thoughts doesn't work. Trying not to think about something is the surest way to make sure we think about it more. It's that whole don't think of a pink elephant thing. There you go thinking about it. So if you tell me, Mike, don't think about that time where you were horribly and publicly embarrassed in front of hundreds of people, yeah, that's the surest way to get me to think about it more. Instead, invite the brain to shift into another train of thought. Instead of trying not to think about that thing, try using the body to engage the brain in another way. Many times I find myself ruminating. Guess what? I'm alone and not doing anything. So get your legs to literally walk your brain over to an activity and do something else. The brain can only do a couple things at a time before it has to let something go. Many find that letting the body engage in something physical, like an activity that requires hand-eye coordination or engaging higher thinking processes like working on a math problem, helps the brain shift when it is stuck. So think, What can I do that will allow the brain to have to give immediate attention to what I'm doing? And then try some of that. Finally, learning to reframe or considering a situation from an alternate point of view can be helpful in shifting away from rumination. Talking with friends, loved ones, and a trusted therapist can help with reframing. Some people reframe by embracing a learning moment. For example, what can I learn from this to help me move forward? That can be helpful for some people. Some people reframe by stepping back and remembering their bigger picture, what's most important to them. One of the most endearing things to me about the character Ted Lasso is his tendency to reframe from a growth perspective, his own and others. People and relationships are the big picture for him, and he allows himself and others to be human, to learn and grow. Now, Ted has plenty that he could choose to ruminate on, but he practices letting things go. He doesn't dwell. He doesn't stay too long in the past before he starts looking to the future. Now, I will probably never get to the Ted Lasso level of being able to let go of things. I mean, he's an exaggerated fictional character after all.
Do you believe in ghosts, Ted?
I do. But more importantly, I think they need to believe in themselves.
But watching him is a good reminder to me that I can practice this skill. I can practice avoiding unhelpful rumination. And in practicing, I can get a little better at it, especially when I remember it does literally nothing for me. In this now iconic scene, where Rebecca's ex seeks to belittle and hurt, let's watch Ted bring the spirit of these principles together.
So, Rebecca, it's time to be friends again.
Especially since Bex and I are going to be sitting with you every week in that owner's box.
I'm not going every week.
Well, I am.
And every week when they shove a camera in my face and ask me how I think you're doing, I will tell them. It'll be relentless.
So, Rupert, y'all take your darts over here pretty seriously, huh? Let's see what we got here. Hey, there it is.
Do you like darts, Ted?
Oh, they're okay. I'm more of a, you know, a cornhole man myself. Yeah. Oh.
Yeah. How about a game? I mean, we could, you know, maybe wager. Say, £10,000?
How about this? If you win, I'll let you pick the starting lineup of the last two games of the season. But if I win, you can't go anywhere near the owner's box, at least not while Rebecca's still in charge.
Ted, what the hell are you doing?
Well, I believe some folks call it white knighting, but I don't know. I'm just following my gut here. It's okay.
Ted.
It's okay.
What do you think?
You're on.
Okay.
Double in, double out.
Whatever you say, Rupert Deuce. Yeah, just let me know if I'm winning or losing, all right?
Oh, I forgot I had these on me.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wait a second. I forgot I'm left-handed. Oh. I was gonna be a hoot.
Mate, what do I need to win?
Two triple 20s and a bullseye.
Good luck.
You know, Rupert, guys have underestimated me my entire life. And for years, I never understood why. It used to really bother me. But then one day, I was driving my little boy to school, and I saw this quote by Walt Whitman. It was painted on the wall there. It said, "Be curious, not judgmental." And I like that. So I get back in my car and I'm driving to work. And all of a sudden it hits me. All them fellas that used to belittle me, not a single one of them were curious. You know, they thought they had everything all figured out. And so they judged everything and they judged everyone. And I realized that they're underestimating me. Who I was had nothing to do with it. Because if they were curious, they would ask questions, you know? Questions like, have you played a lot of darts, Ted? Oh! Which I would have answered, yes, sir. Every Sunday afternoon at a sports bar with my father from age 10 till I was 16 when he passed away. Barbecue sauce. 'Cause the players gonna play.
When you catch yourself ruminating because of something that happened, a failure, a loss, a disappointment, or hurt, try being curious, not judgmental. See where it takes you. If you find content in the Play Therapy series helpful, interesting, or at least better than a poke in the eye, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share with a friend.
Look at Isaac. He looks like Rodin sculpture in cleats.
Boots. They call cleats boots.
Well, I thought you said that the trunk of a car was a boot.
Also a boot.
Hold on now. If I were to get fired from a job where I'm putting cleats in the trunk of my car.
You got the boot for putting boots in the boot.
I love that.